Well, good morning. You may have a seat. Good to see you all this morning. My name is Keith. I'm one of the pastors here at Timberline. I want to welcome you. And I'm going to start this morning by expressing a controversial opinion. I love snow.
Amen.
I knew that might stir things up. I recognize that that's probably can cause some division among the body by expressing that, but I do love snow. I've always loved snow, and I know that it causes a lot of work, makes travel kind of dangerous, but I will never get over, the joy of seeing a new, fresh, falling snow. There's just something about that beauty, something about just kind of a new start to things, and it reminds me of Isaiah 1:18. It says, "Come, let us reason together, though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow." And so it's a reminder of God's forgiveness, of his grace, of his mercy. And so even you non-snow lovers, I pray that as much as you might detest it, as much as you might want to just crawl back into bed and just wait till it's all over, I hope that even in spite of that, you can still see a reminder of God's grace and his forgiveness of sins in that. So this morning, a couple other announcements before I get going any further, because I'm going to forget again. I need the ushers to come up for the bucket offering. And our bucket offering is not our regular offering. It's an offering that we say we eat less than others can eat, period. And every penny goes to help fighting extreme poverty around the world. And right now, the proceeds we're raising are going for relief efforts in Gaza. And we will give you some more updates on that as we get a little bit further into things. Not a lot of announcements this morning, but there are a couple important ones. Just some dates to remind you of. Sunday, February 25th, next Sunday, we're going to have a movie night right here at church at 6 o'clock. We're going to be showing the movie Jesus Revolution, and it's just a night. There's not a big agenda. It's just a time to come out, to fellowship together, to eat some popcorn, and to watch a good movie. So popcorn and drinks will start at 5:30. The movie will start at 6. Partnership 101 is our class that we have that helps explain who and what Timberline is and what it means to become a partner or a member with us and what that looks like. And we have another class coming up on March 17th after church. If you've been coming to Timberline for a short time or for a long time, it doesn't matter. We'd encourage you to consider coming out just to learn a little bit more about who we are and what makes us tick. Lunch is provided. And if you're interested in coming, please contact the church office by Wednesday, March 13th. And then two last quick announcements. It's that time of year again. We're going to be looking ahead to our summer calendar. And we're going to have our annual baptism service this year on Sunday, July 14th. And weather permitting, we will once again be at the Nastinger's Pond. Hopefully we don't get rained out this year. But if you have any interest in being baptized, if that's something that you feel God is laying on your heart, you have not taken that step of faith, and you would like to explore that, please come talk to Benji or I. And we'd love to kind of have a discussion with you and get started on that. So just something to start thinking about as we get closer to summer. And then finally, last announcement, just encourage you, this is another fun morning. We get to do something we hardly ever do here at Timberline, and that's dedicate a baby. So we are dedicating, dedicating Michael and Allie Hudson. We are dedicating Noah Hudson, the son of Michael and Allie Hudson, at the beginning of the second service, to encourage you to hang out, to stay, to witness that as we welcome and dedicate another little one here to Timberline. So with that, I think I'm done talking, so feel free to stand up and to greet each other, and we'll continue in worship.
Burns in the darkness.
2:4-5 says, God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace we have been saved. God, we thank you so much for your love and your mercies that are new every morning. God, they fill us up, Lord, with a peace that passes all understanding. Lord, as we trust in you, we trust in your provision. We trust that you will love us to take care of us, Lord. I pray that you will be glorified through our actions and through the love that we share because of what you've done for us. The love of God is greater far than tongue or pen can ever tell. It goes beyond the highest star and reaches to the lowest hell. The guilty pair bowed down with care. God gave his son to win. His erring child he reconciled and pardoned from his.
Oh, love of God. was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all.
Save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exalt over you with loud singing. Lord, this morning, we give you all the glory and the praise. God, we are amazed. We stand here in your love, and we are amazed at the miracle of your love. Like no other, God, you came and you sacrificed everything so that we could be called a child of God. Lord, we thank you that we stand in your love this morning, redeemed and washed white as snow, Lord. We praise you. We thank you, God. We did not earn it. We could not deserve it. But you did it anyway, out of love for us. God, we praise you. We thank you so much. Amen. You may be seated.
And the ushers can come up for the morning offering. Let's offer this together. Father, your love toward us is generous and abundant. We are grateful for your love, and we trust you. And so, God, this morning we come with our tithe, we come with our hearts, we come with our time, we come with our life, and we offer it to you because you have proven that you are trustworthy. And so, God, we come to give you honor and to give you praise. So would you be honored in this offering? Would you be honored with our time this morning? Would you be honored with our fellowship, with our thoughts, with the meditations of our heart? May your kingdom come and your will be done. In Jesus' name, amen. You guys can go ahead. Good morning, my name is Benji. I'm one of the pastors here at Timberline. As we're singing, this morning about God's immense love for us, some friends came to mind this morning who are grieving significant loss. And I'm a very emotional person, so emotions come easy for me. And I was just struck by how completely and thoroughly God's love is surrounding them, which is a great blessing to know that more real and eternal than our struggle and our pain is God's love. So wherever you're coming from this morning, whether you're coming from a season of joy, a season of conviction, a season of hardship, a season of loss, may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face toward you and give you his peace. God's love is here this morning, and he is good. May you be encouraged and welcomed into his arms this morning. The beginning of my sermon was not staged to be an emotional moment, so we're going to transition gears here. We are talking about God's love this morning, so that was an appropriate thought. Thank you, Nicole, for leading us in songs about God's love. I discovered a few weeks ago, on a lighthearted note, on my phone, there's a number of audiobooks that are free and easy to listen to, and I'm all about things that are free. I'm a good Mennonite. So in the last few weeks, I've listened to a number of classics on this app that I found. Some were fun, like A Christmas Carol, or The Great Gatsby. Others were less fun, like Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. That was the biggest waste of my entire life. So others that were less fun included The Life and Narrative of Frederick Douglass and 12 Years a Slave. Not because they were boring or aimless, like Alice was, but because they were just hard to read. Two true stories about slaves in America. And some of the horrors of those stories take place very close to where we're sitting right here, about 200 years ago. You can hardly listen to the stories that these men share without shivering or getting a knot in your stomach. As human beings treat other human beings with such hatred and contempt. The one girl is sprightly and cheerful, one of the hardest and fastest workers on the plantation, but she also happens to be beautiful. And so her master takes advantage of her, often, which is a horrific abuse by itself. But then also the wife knows about it, and so the wife beats the girl often because she hates her. And anytime the plantation master feels guilty about anything, he beats her and blames it on her. And then anytime the husband and wife argue about anything, be it something in the kitchen or something about their children, he ends the argument by promising to go beat the girl because he knows that that'll make his wife happy. And they can't get rid of her because she's the best worker.
And so, you know, ideally she would slow down her pace a little bit and not be the best worker so that they could get rid of her. But if she slows down, she just gets beaten again. And story after story, I mean, that's just one character in these stories filled with unimaginable, to me, abuse. I can only listen to these stories when I'm in a good state of mind or I just get really sad or really angry. Many times as I'm listening to these real stories, stories that still take place around the world today, what really stuck out to me was simply humans treating other humans like they're not humans. Just shocking horror. So you have this first group of people who often in the South identify as Christians, and even in the narratives, the slaves writing are saying, like, these men read their Bible and pray every day faithfully, probably more than some of us do. And they come face to face, eye to eye, with these other human beings made in the image of God, people that God loves and cherishes and died for. And this first group treats the second group as if they were crops to be harvested and consumed, as if they were inanimate, feelingless dirt. It's enough to just make your skin crawl. And I was thinking, you know, one simple way that we could view sin is like treating others as anything less than a child of God. Now, this isn't a perfect definition. It's lacking and incomplete. So I'm not trying to make a theological statement by this, but just trying to view something from a different perspective, maybe. Sin is like treating somebody else, anytime we treat somebody else less than a child, a beloved child of God. That's like sin. You know, I love children. I really do. They can get on my nerves, of course, like anybody. But I love the creativity, the simplicity, the vivacity of kids. You know, they're just out there for it. Few things can melt your heart like hearing the giggle of a baby. I have a really good video of Lucy if you want to see it. Or witnessing the abuse of a child. Both of those experiences are extremely stirring to us. Children need tenderness. They need compassion. They need discipline and order. They need protection. They need help. They're growing. They're learning. They need love. And the way that God designed all of humanity is that we as humans are supposed to treat each other as children of God. God's children. Meaning both we are 2-year-olds learning how to not throw tantrums anymore, so we need grace. And also we're God's children. You know, I've noticed Alethea does get different attention at Timberline than the average Timberline 2-year-old. Not that it's biased or not that it's bad, it's not a problem, but everybody knows my daughter. And so everybody pays, you know, and there's a certain level of respect when you know someone's parent, you have a different kind of relationship with your child versus somebody that you just don't know. And when we're supposed to interact with each other as if you are God's child. Somebody that I love a lot and who loves me a lot loves you a lot. And that creates a unique and special relationship. Except that this one applies to everyone. We are called to love and honor and build each other up as children of God. But the reality is, a lot of the world is busy doing the opposite. People take advantage of each other. People say things that belittle others and tear them down. In our pursuit of our own comfort and pleasure, we take away the comfort and pleasure of other people. Those who have plenty don't always share with those who have none. People are often treated poorly instead of being treated as cherished children of God. From the beginning, God has called his people to treat each other as children of God, as image bearers, as humans with dignity and worthy of respect. And even when those people are like children, selfish, tantrum-throwing, and even hurtful toward others, the people of God are not supposed to respond with revenge and be hurtful to the hurtful. The people of God are called to respond to hurt with love. Even when he doesn't treat me like a child of God, I am still called to treat him like a child of God. Now, obviously, Jesus did this supremely. Some people were kind to Jesus, but lots of people were terrible to him. And yet he always responded in perfect love. He showed each individual that he met that they were valuable, that their voice and their experience was important, that he cared about their story, both their struggles and their joys. He cherished and loved each one like he would his own child. Most people in the dog-eat-dog world out there don't know that they are image bearers. They don't really understand that they are valued and loved. Maybe they've always been told or treated like they were trash. And many people believe this about themselves. They believe. Maybe they wouldn't say it out loud, but in their core, they believe that they are not lovable. They have a deep mistrust for others because others have hurt them so deeply. And so they don't even treat themselves with respect. They abuse themselves, both physically with substances or self-harm, eating too much or eating too little, or as well as inwardly, mentally and emotionally berating themselves. And this is our mission field. Both the slave masters and the slaves. Those who are cruel to others and those who identify as a nobody that deserves to be hated. And I think as we go out, we most often find that all of us tend to be a little bit of both of those. Like a master, a slave master, all of us are selfish and sinful. We choose sin. And like a slave, we also have all been lied to and hurt and feel deep insecurity and fear. And we tend to distrust others and God. Meanwhile, the truth that is deeper than our hurt and our insecurity is that God, who is supreme, he does really love us. And he wants to set us free from sin and from deceit. He wants us to experience his love and his holiness. This is what Jesus showed us on the cross. He showed us that sin is a really big deal. It is really bad. It's very hurtful. It causes death and harm. It's ugly and condemning, and no one can escape the consequences of sin. Hence, the cross was necessary. But in his love, Jesus took our consequences of sin. Sin is a big deal, and it does need to be punished, and Jesus took that punishment from us, for us. That was in his love. And also, in his holiness, he bore the consequences of our sin in a just and righteous way, showing us that he does take sin seriously, and sin is always dealt with justly. And when we receive Jesus as Savior, we experience freedom from bondage, which is God's kindness. We're no longer slaves. We are free. There's no longer death and pain. We are alive and can experience healing. We also get to experience God's holiness, because not only are we free from the consequences of sin, where the power of sin is lost on us, and we're not stuck sinning all the time anymore. We are free to abide in God's holiness and his goodness, his purity. We get to experience a new type of life away from the grip that sin has on us. We're no longer living in the world's lies that we're ugly and stupid and unlovable and that we're always in danger. We can dwell in the reality that God is our protector, and he has designed us with purpose and dignity, and he desires us to confidently be a part of his family and his righteousness and his freedom. That is our greatest identity. That is the truth that is truer than all of the lies we are taught to believe about ourselves and the world around us. That we are children of God, loved, loved, loved by him. And that is also, along with being our identity, that is our mission, to live out and share that truth with others, discipling them in the ways of Jesus. The truth is, God is love. And we are called to love, and we can love because he first loved us. Love is patient and kind. Love does not envy or boast. It is not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice at wrongdoing, but rejoices with the truth. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. Love never ends. Father God, we thank you that you have loved us so fully. We thank you that you have been patient with us. You have been kind with us. You are not irritable or grumpy with us. You don't rejoice in our sin, but you rejoice in the truth. You, in your love, you actually bear all things. You endure all things, and your love for us never fails. Lord, would you teach us to trust your love? And this morning, would you show us how we can even more abide and dwell in your love? We need your spirit to guide us this morning. Would you come and lead us? In Jesus' name. I hope these words are sounding more and more familiar to you, to the point that you could just quote them in your sleep, because that is kind of the goal. This is what it means to love others like they're a human, to love others like they are children of God. And there are two phrases in this passage that we're going to look at this morning. And I want us to remember this part of the Bible is written in Greek. And so anytime we read it in English, we're reading someone's best shot at a translation. ESV is what Keith and I use most often. This morning, I don't particularly like their word choice, and that's okay. What we're going to talk about this morning is how love is not irritable or resentful. We're going to park there. But other translations and looking at the Greek words, I think there's better words perhaps for those two thoughts. Irritable meaning like easily angered or easily provoked. I kind of like easily angered the most, and we're probably going to use that most this morning. And love is not resentful, which can literally be translated as it does not take into account the wrong suffered. Or in the NIV, it says, it keeps no record of being wronged. Love is not easily angered, and it does not keep track of being wronged. I feel like easily angered people rarely think of themselves as easily angered people. All humans are professional justifiers. Most often, angry people think of themselves as someone who is standing up for what is right. Anger is often expressed with an air of superiority. If those dumb people just knew how to drive like I know how to drive, we wouldn't have any problems out here. If my husband cleaned up the house like I cleaned up the house, we wouldn't have any problems around here. Clearly, I'm the better person, and if that person could just be like me, we would be okay. And in these ways, anger, which is real anger, it feels small and insignificant. It's not that big of a deal. It's just idiots out there driving dumb. And because it's a little sin, or not really even a sin at all, who cares about anger? It's not that big of a deal. Yet the Bible again and again returns to condemn anger as one of the most destructive elements of human nature. 4 times in the New Testament, anger makes the list of people who practice these things do not enter the kingdom of heaven. And Paul says that being slow to anger is a leadership requirement. You could have somebody who is super gifted and a passionate person. They know their community. They would be a great fit for their job. But if they are quick to anger, that alone disqualifies them from leadership. Because love is not easily angered and does not keep record of being wronged. Being irritable and unforgiving is like treating another person like they are beneath you. Like they are not as human as you are. That they're not worthy of your kindness and your respect. And that is sin. And that is not love. Anger comes in many forms. So I think it'll be helpful this morning to talk about what triggers anger in people, to maybe identify what we're talking about when we're talking about anger. You know, I never identified as an angry person until one time I had lunch with this other pastor who I had met once or twice but didn't really know him. We sat down for an hour and a half, and at the end of the conversation, he was like, so what are you going to do with all that anger you got there? I was like, what are you talking about? We just had lunch for an hour. What? And then he very graciously pointed out how in the last hour and a half, I had just dumped all of these things that I was very angry about. And I was taken aback, and I had to check myself. And over the next couple months after that, I grew in self-awareness and realized that, wow, I'm angry often. But I didn't know that about myself because I didn't look for it. And you tend to find what you look for. So I thought I was a very happy and sweet person. Anyways, all that to say, there's different things that trigger us to simple, easily angered temper. So what are we even talking about as we talk about love is not angry? One aspect of anger is carelessness. And this is going to be the most vague descriptor because careless people aren't setting out to be angry. And they probably don't even know when they are angry, which makes it kind of a difficult category to describe. Yet, from the abundance of our heart, our mouth speaks. Our tongue betrays what's going on inside. Careless people may not set out to be nefarious, but they end up hurting people with their snide comments and sharp words. Maybe it comes in the form of generic complaint. Oh, I wish. Or those people. Maybe it comes out in exaggerating a story to make a point at the expense of someone else. Maybe it comes when you're discussing an opinion and you just kind of assume that anyone who would disagree with you was obviously a fool. Those are words coming out of anger, and those are attacks at other people. We slip in little insults, or maybe, can you believe it? We're not trying to be mean, and yet the motivation behind what we're saying is anger, usually about things that don't really matter. Can you believe that grocery store line was so long? Like, calm down. Does this matter? Does this qualify as slow to anger or easily angered? In these moments, we treat people like we think they're idiots instead of treating them like they are children who need compassion and help. This type of carelessness, it reminds me of the character Peter in the Bible. He seems to be a man who just puts his foot in his mouth most of the time. Sometimes he puts a sword in his mouth, if you want to follow that analogy, because the day that he chops off the guy's ear, I just wonder, like, did Peter wake up that morning and think, you know, today I'm going to dismember someone from the temple? Probably not. But he also wasn't, like, abiding in God's word, and so when the moment struck, without thinking, he just acted and probably regretted it in about 5 seconds because Jesus is like, stop it, you dummy. In his carelessness, anger controlled his decision-making. In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus says, you have heard that it was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council, and whoever says, you fool, will be liable to the hell of fire. Anger is a big deal. And we often like to justify our anger and say, well, this is the good kind of anger. Well, when the punishment for bad anger is being liable to judgment on level with murder, tread carefully in what you call good anger. It is not something that we should be careless about. We should take anger very seriously. You know, if there is a carelessly, easily angered person in your life, I would encourage you to pray about how you could lovingly address it with them. And if they don't listen to you, how you and another person could lovingly address it in them. Because they probably don't know that they are easily angered. And it would be beneficial for you to help them in their sanctification journey. Because we need to take anger seriously. Another anger trigger is pressure or stress. We don't even know we're angry because we're not feeling angry. We're feeling busy. We're feeling important. I think of Martha in Luke 10, working hard in the kitchen as her sister Mary is simply talking to Jesus. What a waste. Martha is feeling all the pressure of the meal and the guests and the expectations. She's not trying to be angry. She's just trying to get it done. The irony of this type of anger is that the victim of the anger is rarely the cause of the anger. We're stressed about our work, and so we lash out at a coworker about something dumb. Or we're feeling pressure about the next event, or we need to leave the house, and so we lash out at the kids for something completely unrelated to what we're feeling stressed about. This kind of easy anger is so common, and it's so easy. The best thing that we can do when we're feeling pressure like this is to acknowledge it, say it out loud, understand that there's pressure in this moment. Maybe share it, tell a friend or a coworker or the child before you yell at them like, hey, by the way, mommy's under pressure today. Add some accountability to yourself and pray about it. Ask God to give you the patience to respond carefully and not carelessly. You know, this might sound dumb, but mornings when Melody's playing on worship, you know, that's the only morning that I have both girls to myself and I need to do everything at home by myself. I'm just like, ooh, we need to get to church on time. But I also work here, so I need to get to church on time. Those are moments when I need to remind myself, okay, Benji, you are putting a lot of pressure on yourself. Watch what you say before you open your mouth. Because otherwise it is very easy to be angry with a 2-year-old who does not understand what's going on. Psalm 55 says, cast your burden on the Lord and he will sustain you. You're feeling that pressure, you're feeling that tension, cast that one on the Lord and he will sustain you. Now the same is true when we're exhausted, where we're sick, physically weak in some way. It's very easy to allow anger to boil because we're feeling under pressure in a different way. We're feeling exhausted, like we don't have the energy to get through. And the same instructions apply. Acknowledge it, call it out, share it, and ask God to sustain you, and he will. Another trigger of anger is unresolved hurt. And this is where we dip into love does not keep record of being wronged. Now, for a more full conversation on this idea, go and listen to every single sermon out there about forgiveness and bitterness. They're all good. Sin is really ugly, and it causes chaos and pain. And when we have been sinned against, somebody sinned in our direction, unfairly, we are given the burden of needing to deal with the chaos and pain that their sin caused in our lives. We didn't choose to be hurt, but it is up to us to deal with that hurt and not live in anger and bitterness. Unchecked personal wounds can cause us to be very harmful, even though it's not our fault that it happened in the first place. There are hundreds of examples that could be used, but the one that was coming to mind as I was writing was Joseph's brothers. The reality is, these are 10 men whose dad didn't love them. Joseph's father treated Joseph like a human. He was loved and cherished and prized, but the other sons were treated as less than. They were just the people who took care of his sheep. Basically, they were his slaves. And the brothers didn't work through that hurt or take it to God, and so they allowed it to rule them, and their anger and hatred grew until they all but murdered their brother and then sold him as a slave. Just like the slave master's wife beat the pretty girl because she didn't process her own hurt and insecurity in the situation. And so she inappropriately used her hurt to hurt others. When we are wounded, it might not be our fault, but it is still up to us to work through that wound and that hurt. The thing with hurts is that we don't always even know that they're there until all of a sudden they pop up. I didn't know I was grieving this morning until I was. Similarly, 2 years ago, when I was on the youth trip to West Virginia, I got a call that one of my close friends had died. And that was very hard, being in the middle of a week away, being responsible. So anyways, I grieved that loss, thought I was good, had worked through it, thought I was in a good place. But then, as we were preparing for the Dominican trip this year, I just had a lot of anxiety that I didn't understand where it was coming from. I'm not typically an anxious person, but every time I just thought about being in the DR, I got sick, and it was just this unhelpful, I couldn't process details very well. And so it didn't make any sense to me, and so I was like, I just have to pray and ask God to show me what's going on, because I don't know what's going on. And so I sat down and prayed for an hour, and after a while, he just showed me that I was subconsciously, but fully believing that if we go on this trip, somebody that I love will die. I didn't even know that that wound was there, but it was. I was harboring anger toward God and fear. But now that I knew it was there, I could process it with him. I was able to pray through it and actually enjoy the trip. And I didn't have anxiety after that because I was able to process that. Now, that was an easier thing to process than other hurts. Some hurts are a lot harder to process, and the anxiety that's attached to them is a much bigger deal. Forgiveness is hard, and it can come up again and again. In some cases, every time we see our offender, we have to work through forgiveness again. But we, who have been forgiven much, must forgive, or we cannot experience the fullness of God's love for others, or even for us. We have to process our own hurts. Fourth trigger of anger is a guilty conscience. Maybe we're living in secret sin, or maybe we haven't really processed God's grace ever in our own lives. And the shame that we feel causes us to push others away or blame others and try to make ourselves feel better by either protecting our secrets or putting others down so that we feel like we're higher. Sin separates us from God. It just does. And God is the source of love. So when we feel far from God, love is hard and anger is easy. The story of King Saul in 1 Samuel is a great example. Saul very specifically sinned against God, and God removed his favor from Saul and gave it to David instead. But Saul was still the king. And instead of repenting from his sin and following God's will, Saul dug in his heels and grasped to every bit of power and fame he could cling to. But in doing so, he dug his grave and his shame deeper and deeper. Had he repented, he could have been a free man that lived a joy-filled life. But instead, he was tormented by evil spirits. He spent the majority of his kingship trying to assassinate the most loyal and powerful captain in his own army. He split his own family and killed his own sons because of his guilt, and he lived a life filled with anger because he didn't deal with his own guilt. 1 John chapter 1 says that if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Jesus wants to clear our conscience, and he's already done the work. He's just waiting for us to humble ourselves so that we can come to him in honesty and be free. Free from the burden of sin, including the burden of unnecessary, easy anger. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. We just need to bring it to Christ, and he will clear the conscience for us. And lastly, and most broadly, unmet expectations trigger anger in us. This is very broad. It kind of encompasses all of them. I experience this almost every day at home. I expected to sleep another half an hour, not getting up right now. I expected to leave on time. Jokes to that one. I expected this delicious meal to be satisfying to you, but it was not. And if I'm not careful, I can get very angry in those moments. But this can happen on a much broader scale. The Pharisees, for example, expected the Messiah to walk into their neighborhood and say, "Oh, thank you so much for being wonderful, godly men who saved your nation because of your holiness and your rules. Thank you for being wonderful and pious." Instead, Jesus shows up and is like, "Y'all need some grace, and your rules are not helpful." And he puts them in their place in a loving way. And their unmet expectations infuriate them to the point of seeking a way to kill him. Friends, lots of things in our lives are not going to go the way that we want them to. Welcome to the world. Glad you're born. How we respond to these occasions displays whether our hearts are flowing with God's love, that is patient and kind and humble, or whether our hearts are flowing with anger and self-seeking bitterness. When a political leader makes a decision that you don't like, are you tempted to be angry? Are you tempted to gossip about it and say, "Can you believe? Did you really expect a politician to agree with your opinion? Have you lived here very long?" First of all, it's a little bit naive of you. You should have seen this coming. But also, instead of getting easily angered, why are you not drawn to pray and to ask God's blessing, to ask God to convict and to bring repentance, and even to ask for grace for us who will deal with the consequences of that decision that we disagreed with? Why is anger our natural response? Is it right for me to expect to make it through the grocery store without a tantrum? Is that really reasonable that I would expect that from my 2-year-old? Honey, have you met? High hopes are good, and we should have high hopes, and we should aim high. But our expectations should be realistic. Broadly speaking, when human beings sin, are we surprised by that? Does that make us angry? Now, it is good that sin upsets us. We should never grow so callous to sin that it doesn't affect us anymore. God always takes sin seriously. But in your anger about the sin of other people, be careful that you don't start sinning. Ephesians says, "Be angry, but do not sin." It's okay to acknowledge the injustice of sin in the world. It's okay to have feelings about that, but watch yourself. The Bible condemns anger often and leads us to forgiveness often. When my daughter runs at me and tries to tackle me, she's small enough that I can stand firm and I can absorb all of her energy and force without really even twitching. If an adult would do that to me, you very likely could lay me flat. When we are hit with the effects of sin from other people, instead of retaliating, bouncing back, or falling over in despair, we are called to be people who absorb. When we are hit, instead of retaliating in anger, the living God who lives inside of us can take the hit for us, which he already did on the cross. And Christ in us can absorb the frustrations and unmet expectations, the hurts that we're experiencing, the exhaustion that we're experiencing. And instead of being trapped in cycles of anger, we can live freely and love freely, and in so doing, put God's rich and steadfast love on display to the world. We don't have to be angry, friends. This is our Great Commission call, to be representatives and ambassadors of Jesus and his work. This is what Jesus displayed in his life, and this is what it means to be human, to treat others as if they are cherished and honored children of God, to love them, all of them, all the time. And love is not easily angered. The antidote to sinful anger is to abide in Christ. There is no quick fix to easy anger. There is no incantation that you can just say in the moment and be done. We need the power of the Holy Spirit to actively be leading us and producing in us his fruit. We need to regularly meditate, not on that stupid person who did that dumb thing, can you believe it? How often do we meditate on those things and think about them and scrutinize them and slander them in our minds? Instead, we need to meditate on God's word, who he is, and his will for us. Those things that are true and noble and pure and lovely and admirable and excellent. That's what we are called to meditate on. When we abide in him, sinful anger can have no place in us. When we abide in him, we walk in love. God, we want to be people who abide in love and put on display your love for the world, both to the corrupt people who are hurting others and to those who are oppressed, that both would see your love and compassion, your justice and your mercy. Lord, would you set us free from the bondage of being tied to sin and the need to sin? Would you fill us with your love that we can experience it, and also that we can share it with others, and also that we could respond to you in that same kind of love? God, we need your help. Oh, God, we need your help. Have mercy on us sinners, but lead us in your way of everlasting life. Would you stand up for the blessing this morning? May the word of God be your joy, your source of life, and the object of your thoughts. May the love of God be your strength, your motivation, and your instrument in labor. May you be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry. May Christ in you display to others the goodness of our God and the righteousness and mercy of his kingdom and his reign. And may you personally be filled with the fullness of Christ's love as you leave your sin at the foot of the cross. Go from here and walk in his love.